Now, after avoiding playing by rearranging my lists, I created a whole bunch of new ones sorted by eras for Board Game Geek. It's where all the videos are compiled. There's a link to them from the YouTube channel if you watch that way. If you watch from one of the other ways, go to YouTube and check to my channel, to my main channel. Or to Board Game Geek, and you can find it under the name Callendale. Okay, so anyway, I wasn't going to have time to actually play anything, but I figured I'd set up the situation with the Roman leaders. Only the Romans change. And we got a new Roman field council. We kept the proconsul and the propraetor on. They're both under siege. I'm not really sure that I could replace them under any reasonable circumstances. So I kept them in place, even though they're not necessarily terribly good. And I've got a siege working here. I've got this here. I also wasn't certain whether or not I could get a dictator. I don't remember if I had a major victory. It's these things that, you know, my style of play, wandering away and everything, I haven't figured out yet a way to mark it down. I'm pretty sure that there has been a major victory against a Roman army of sufficient size, at least two double legions. But I'm not sure that it had 30% losses, which is the secondary factor there. It may well have. On the other hand, I'm not sure there's much value to me having a dictator at this point. I have enough leaders. I'm going to have trouble raising another legion. I really just need to... I have room for one, because I think I screwed up and didn't put a double legion down in Rome when I should have. But that's okay, because... Anyway. Whatever. Lucania, our field council, now his dominion's in Lucania instead of Campania. So he's going to have trouble moving out of Lucania if he has to. Now, he's the field council, so he can do that fairly easily if he wishes to. And really nothing else to set up. There's no revolts or anything like there are in the Italian scenario. So it's a lot simpler to do the turn end conditions than I had in the other scenario. Okay, and the current turn kind of opens up, it does open up with a pick for the council. He raised troops in Rome, another legion, set out on a march to Apulia to deal with Arpi. There was a siege going on there. As he got into that hex, Pyrrhus attempted an interception. There are little counters to mark that failed interceptions, because it could matter if he was out in the open or whatever. He has a penalty if he's attacked under those circumstances, but it's not really an issue right here. Basically, it indicates that you've been snuck up on. Was able to slip in and hit the Tarentine besieging army without being caught, and then was able to coordinate, and Pyrrhus was unable to coordinate, the forces inside. So now he's got a huge army facing this. Now he's the top leader here, and he's a C rank, which is not bad at all compared to the E rank for the Tarentians. So this is unlikely to go well for Pyrrhus's allies. Indeed, that worked out to be a success for the Romans for the most part. Well, entirely. They won a major battle victory that affected some of the chart locations. You can see these guys are still not Roman allies. They remain that way until they hit down here. But the Romans have to recover. They got a continuation, so they went back into the city. Now, they wouldn't actually absolutely have to. They could have gone and tried to besiege Pyrrhus or besiege these forces. But Pyrrhus is strong enough that they don't want to really be out in the open with a disorganized army. And that... So here's kind of the problem. They could be put under siege, and if they don't get to rally their forces and come out and fight, they're going to be in some trouble because of the siege attrition checks, which are really, really painful when you're under siege. So this is really a game of bottling up the enemy's forces under siege hoping to reduce them that way, while maybe you've got other forces that can do something else. And it's kind of unfortunate to have your entire army here. I probably could have done fine without as many units coming out, but unfortunately for me, I had two of the commanders sitting in here and needed to allocate the other, the Rome Council, somewhere, you know, to try to save them, and now they're all allocated together in the same place. Sometimes you get kind of weird results in a game like this. The triple with the siege attrition, three of them shot out in a row. And what that means is there will be no more siege attrition this year. That's something that feels a little wrong. I almost feel like the siege attrition chits should, one of them should go back in or something, simply because there should almost always be one in there. Same with the auguries, knowing that there won't be a random event. All the same, it does scramble up the situation a little bit. Maybe they made it through the hot part of the summer and now they have enough water and food or whatever that they can be pretty sure that there's not going to be attrition. But it does feel a little strange to me in the same sort of way that, say, picking a card to play that has an event and an action cost in a CDG has an action value. It takes away from the believability, the suspension of disbelief that the game requires. Where something that, you know, maybe continuously had chit pulls with the possibility of events being generated off some of the other die rolls. However, events being generated off some of the other die rolls, there is one like that, and I can't remember if it's for this scenario or the previous one. There was something where if you roll a zero, something terrible is going to happen. I think it came from an event from here, but I can't rightly remember. And I just don't know anymore. So those kind of things fade away very easily. This is a nice device for the memory, at least. A lot of times, the chits pulled are no events, essentially. So like Hellenius coming up, he's useless to me. If I had lots and lots of forces, if I had three stacks or something that were, well, fourth stack, so I got the two Pyrrhic stacks and the Tarentians, I could go send him in charge of another stack. But he's really no better than most anybody. He's a little better than the Tarentians. I don't feel like he has the right to command them without some other forces in play. And then we get an augury, and that might or might not cause something interesting, and in this case it does. Mago comes into play, and we're going to throw his chits here. Essentially, Carthage has just gotten so worried about Syracuse knocking these guys off and what's going on that they're coming in. And that's going to be a real problem for Pyrrhus, because Syracuse can't hold out on its own against Carthage. But if Pyrrhus's forces can swing down that way, he may be able to turn the tide and win that battle. Otherwise, he's losing valuable territory. Now, I don't know if Carthage has the right to leave Sicily. I know Syracuse doesn't. But I don't see any such restriction against Carthage spreading out a little bit. And oh boy, you know, if Carthage helped Pyrrhus and took southern Italy at this point, that would change future history, wouldn't it? and that's the reason you wish there was kind of a campaign game in here, just stringing scenarios together. The same way that I wish there was one for Imperium Romanum. I'd like to see something where maybe there's not an overall winner or something, but where the events of one scenario generate the next scenario to some extent. You know, if Rome fails here, well, if Rome requires Carthaginian help getting the south of the boot, then the Hannibal scenario is going to be starting out with, you know, without maybe the need for the Alpine crossing or anything like that. Sort of Rome covers that nicely, right? But you'd kind of wish that these more detailed games allowed you to run from one scenario to the other with some sort of continuity. It's just a feeling I have with the operational semi-strategic stuff. I mean, the time scale on this 1 year per turn, that's not really operational. I have to go into a discussion of scope versus scale at some point because I screw it up all the time and I'll continue to do so. But I think a lot of gamers actually have that same kind of issue. Anyway, I managed to find a rule prohibiting the Carthaginians from going across into here. Anyway, the Hannibal scenario is, of course, Second Punic War. The First Punic War scenario is in Carthage, crossing between the two. Hey, maybe there are rules in Carthage for it. But it wouldn't make much sense if Carthage is willing to not cross into southern Italy, as not just willing to not, but disallowed from it as they are in this scenario. It's not going to change the situation too much. Anyway, we had good old Mr. Magoo come in, and he's marched down to here, gathered up all the forces on his way, which is starting to cause some significant attrition losses. It may actually be a mistake to try to gather a huge force like that, but anyway, that's what I did. The game suggests that, well, it notes that there see or makes implications that there are diplomatic control. So somewhere or another, it talks about the diplomatic control markers for Sicily and or for Carthage. There is one for Eastern Sicily, and I don't know, that should be here or something, I guess. I don't know. But there isn't one, and there are some rules for Eastern Sicily in here. They actually have a place. But there isn't anything for Western Sicily, and there is no Carthage marker. Oh, there it is. See, I lied. Okay, so I'll pull the Western Sicily one out. But they're not going to get reinforcements unless they have some special rules, and I don't think they do. Oh, yeah, they do. Here we go. Each year, if Pyrrhus is in Sicily, they get some additional forces. Okay. So, I just keep telling you wrong things. You know, that's the nature of a game like this, is I can't remember, not that I'll lie to you, but that I can't remember all the different special cases. And, you know, by saying them on camera, I'll actually look them up. Otherwise, I might just remember them, you know, keep them in my mind in whatever distorted version I have. And, you know, when a rule book and game itself is kind of organized in such a manner, I can't grasp what all the special cases are. We ran into this with Triumph of Chaos. I'm not sure how you have to impose order on something like this that's just filled with lots of special cases. Certainly counters and stuff help. Also, player aid cards. Obviously, people who actually play Triumph of Chaos play with a bunch of, you know, user-designed player aids. Well, you kind of need that with this, too. And it's kind of this. GMT and other companies have gotten a lot better, GMT especially, at providing what you need to play the game. What would help, you know? There's more of a focus on that nowadays. But this isn't all that long ago, and it is kind of a mess. And you can see, if you look back to, well, obviously it's a mess. They completely, completely failed in this playbook. I mean, this game should not have been published in this condition. I'm in conversation with someone about another game that's more recent that shouldn't have been published in the condition that it's in, where they're trying to rectify it somehow. Hopefully they'll provide materials to people who actually paid for it. But, you know, you see nowadays, GMT with Supreme Commander, they had a big hullabaloo about that, where they said, you know, hey, yeah, we kind of screwed the pooch on this one, and here is the replacements, you know, materials that just didn't make it through properly, that didn't get enough, you know, attention to detail before the game was published. Well, this should have never made it to the printer in the condition it's in. Somebody in the development side or something should have said, we can't go with this, whether or not it's a good game. Of course, I think expectations have changed. I think the expectations that, GMT is setting new standards for everyone, essentially. But you look back not too long ago, and man, they had some pretty crappy standards. And I remember the discussion with Washington's War, which was fairly recent, where they screwed up with the counters and didn't provide everyone with replacement counters. Somewhere with Here I Stand, where they missed giving someone a counter, they missed giving everyone a certain counter and screwed up with the printing. From then on, they've been really, really good about, all right, we're going to replace things. We're not counting on you to buy our $30 magazine to get your extra, the counters that should have come in the game to begin with. And in this case, the rule book that should come. You got to go out and print it yourself. And, if you do so, you end up with these. This is too old anyway. It's up to version 2. And then, maybe pay $20 to bind it or something. You should get it right in the first place, right? So Pyrrhus got the next chip. And instead of sieging this location, he simply marched down here into Lucania, was victorious against the besieging forces, but stuck outside. Now, he stuck outside disrupted. He failed to get his continuation. He would have liked to have gone in. I'm always screwing up in terms of getting the ordering right. I decided not to try to reverse it in this case. Sometimes I would. But here, he could have tried to raise troops, improve the amount of forces he has in the three territories that he actually owns. I still haven't pulled that Western Sicily marker out for the Romans. It should be on the board for them. And then, I marched here. But then my thought was, well, it may be more important to relieve the siege than to raise troops. Although I would be able to get troops here in my army and then troops here after I relieve the siege, which is likely that would happen. I could build the additional troops down here and help the Tarentians have a better force. Of course, they're useless, so, it's going to take them a while to recover with their leadership. So that may be a problem, and it's not like I've got better leaders back here as Pyrrhus's allies. He's really on his own down here trying to fight his way into some kind of decent situation. Sometimes diplomacy doesn't work so well. I sent good old Clinius over to Samnium. Now, there's a big penalty at Samnium. It was at +3, but I was hoping to get another force into play so I could raise even more Italian troops down there. Unfortunately, I rolled kind of lousy. Ended up in the disaster realm with that +3 or whatever. It's only an odd-even disaster. Otherwise, it would be a -1, which would suck. However, then I rolled a natural 0. Ambassador so outrages the notables that he is addressing that the player loses 3 boxes and the ambassador is assassinated on the spot, his head sent back to the OC, pickled in a rather nice vase. On the bright side, I think that means I have my ambassadorship back, although it's a lousy ambassador now instead of my good one. But I can attempt a continuation and maybe try to send another ambassador out. Let me see. Okay, so I get a shot to do that. I'm going to send him to Brutium. Again, I need to raise troops, which is why I'm taking the risks on these suckers. And we'll do a quick one there. This is only a D, and I'm at +2. My chance of success is pretty crappy on Brutium, to tell you the truth. Why don't I send him to Campania instead? Well, the problem with Campania is I have to get that swung way over before I start getting any advantages from it, but that's okay. So here we actually have -2 by my reading of how the chart goes, and that's kind of cool. And I get 2 extra boxes there. So I push it over into the 0 box. And that's kind of nice. Messina, I can withdraw this. This shit doesn't have any effect anymore. They've been knocked out of the out of the game. And I still haven't put the damn Sicilians on the board. Oops. Now I'm going to continue and then start raising troops, and I don't know what I'll do next. I need to recover these guys, so I'll probably drop them into the city or a city so that on my next pick I can undisrupt them. There really isn't, you know, I could start laying siege to something and I'll probably recover. There aren't many chits left, so maybe that's even a better move than trying to actually recover them directly. Lay siege to the big Roman army. Force it to come out and fight me or whatever, because it's not in, well, it's not in particularly good shape either. One thing to look at here is, looks like Legion 4's in charge there. Yeah, that's the Roman Council. I've only had one of my council chits come up, so there is the possibility that that could recover. Well, there's only one other council chit in there. So, kind of like in a CDG where you're sitting there kind of thinking, it's a little different because you know what's going to come up. You know whether or not these forces are going to be in good enough shape to come out and fight or what. You know, I mean, in a CDG, you often don't know what the other guy's holding in his hand. You usually won't. So you just have to guess with that. Here, you know he can come out and fight. He's got the chit for it. What you don't know is whether or not the player is going to choose to. And that's kind of a different kind of decision making to go there. All right, well, I'll continue with Pyrrhus's activation. We'll see what happens. We finish up the turn with a quick move by Milon. He moves over, grabs the Tarentine forces that are not in great shape. Still disorganized, in fact. Pretty bad shape. To try to lay siege to Capua, but he didn't get a continuation. He's not very good. And Mago marched on to Syracuse, taking some attrition. Huge army near 80 strength points. It's, you know, in this range. It's almost certain to take some on any kind of move at all. Boom. But he's laying siege to Syracuse, and that should be actually fairly easy to take under those conditions. The council was the last chit to come out, and he just recovered. He didn't really need to do that, but he didn't want to come out and fight. He doesn't want to be the attacker with a disorganized army. He feels like Pyrrhus is too good. But he's got, like, the majority of the Roman army in place there, so that's going to be kind of troublesome. Anyway, we get to assign some new positions after we do recovery, and I'll come back with the start of turn 5. Rome's command problems are becoming worse, as I have a whole stack in here, basically two proconsuls here. One thing that I made a mistake about was by making a proconsul there, by collecting up the field, actually the Rome Council and the proconsul there. Now I've got two people of equal rank as proconsuls. One of them's been given the Imperium over Apulia, but that doesn't give him the right to command all forces there or anything like that. So basically I have to leave one of the proconsular armies behind. Elsewhere, we got a new field council, Muse. Not bad in combat, but not terribly quick. And we need somebody who's able to recover forces there. He actually doesn't have a lot of force either. And I wouldn't have wanted him to be my field council, except he's the only loose army I have. And then over here, we got our new Rome council, who's also not terribly impressive at anything. And that means we're going to be adding just two council markers. But we do have lots of proconsular markers in there. So if we end up driving Pyrrhus away, we will have the ability to do a little bit more than we normally would. That's one reason to put more counters in play. But, for example, had I gone for a dictator, I could put the Master of Horse down here. And I don't know how much that would help, but I at the very least, I would have the dictator able to raise troops and send them out with the Rome Council at that point, which would be a nice combination. But I'm just not in a position where I feel like that made a lot of sense. I think I should have taken it. I am at some definite... I'm definitely pushed against the line there. It looks like Sicily's probably going to completely fall, because I've got no way that Pyrrhus can get down there with any sufficient force. He's fighting for his survival right now in southern Italy. Kind of a shame, because the Syracusians would be helpful in fighting there, but right now it seems like I've got better chances down here than fighting Carthage. And at least they're restricted to only being in Sicily and Corsica, Sardinia. The thing I use a little bit of this time for was to look up some rules that I knew existed, but I wasn't sure anymore what they did. I hadn't been using them. Just they're voluntary things, not in terms of optional, but they're at the player's option to use. In particular, devastation and looting were of interest to me. Looting isn't going to mean much anyhow, but here's what's weird about looting. The rules for looting tell you, hey, this will have an effect on the diplomacy of states. Well, when you go to the diplomacy section, and that's in both this version and the new version of my rulebook, they don't. Looting has absolutely no positive use at all. I can't see any reason to do it. Maybe version 2.0 has changed that. But I'm not going to dig up another copy of a rulebook that they just couldn't get right again and again and again. Actually, I probably have a 2.0. It probably is what comes with Carthage. The second one is that devastation does have a major effect, but it has kind of a weird effect in that I could devastate my own province and end up gaining political capital from that. That's just wacky to my ideas. If you devastate a province, you get 4 extra political points on it. I guess it's like terrorizing them into supporting you. Now, I think devastation may have... It has effects on... the attrition level. It doubles the attrition for the area. Let's see if it does anything else. Yeah, it doesn't affect the manpower ratings. So there's no terrible reason not to devastate your own provinces, just to, you know, if they're getting questionable in terms of their alliance capability. But it seems like you have to drive the enemy out of the territory. It seems like more of a something that fits more under either this scenario or the Thunderbolt scenario with Hannibal wandering around than maybe some of the other scenario. Well, in particular the Italian scenario. I think it doesn't have an effect in the Italian scenario, which makes sense. I don't remember. But anyway, I'll take a look at the Carthage rules, see if they make a little bit more sense about the looting, because if I've got an updated rulebook there, maybe it'll help. Not too surprisingly, it's the exact same rules. It's version 2.0, but it doesn't have any significant change in those. You know, leads me to believe, even once this reprinted, they still didn't, you know, really put it through rigorous playtesting. Same developer, too, and same designer, obviously. You'd think after something got kind of this much flack as the first game did, in terms of, hey, you really didn't, you know, get the rules right, you'd think they'd have addressed some of these things. I mean, one person playing through me is finding so many errors in it, and then looks, and it still isn't corrected, some of them, in the later versions. You know, it's pathetic, to tell you the truth. I made fun of the moments in History Game, also by Berg, series, but the Great Battles, Great Leaders, or something like that. But, you know, that was a small company. GMT had been around for a decade when this came out, and it at least there were significant improvements, although the game still wasn't that wasn't completely fixed. By the time of the second game in the series, it looks like there are some major flaws still in the Carthage rules. All right, neat little bit of a story here. The Proconsul got his activation chit, and I sent out the big one, Consular Army 4, to attack. However, I was able, and I also sent the Proprietor. I then was able to coordinate, so the Proconsul came out. Now, that Proconsul was Lavinius here. He did Devotio, whatever, where he killed himself for a +3 bonus. And that actually gave the Romans a slight advantage. Unfortunately, I got an exceptional result with a -1 on it from here. Ended up rolling, I think, a net of 2, which was a 20% victory, 20-5 victory, major victory there. Pyrrhus drives the Romans back into the city. They're useless. And another leader got injured here, Diabella. I don't know where he's from. I don't have him on the list. I think I've been writing him down as Barbula, who hasn't been around for a while. I don't know. Anyway, that just shows how much use I have of that. You know what I forgot to do was to play Guile into this. That die roll could have been modified by Guile rolls, and there Pyrrhus probably would have blown an extra couple of points. That and the Romans would have blown 1. Instead of the 2 table, we probably would have been at the 30-5, but hey, so be it. Major victory. Didn't have a lot of effect on the diplomacy because most of these were already pretty far over in the camp. The only thing it affected was Samnium dropped at 1. I mean, you know, difference between a 3 and a 4, but already in your camp, that's almost inconsequential. Only devastations to a province are going to swing it that kind of distance. Anyway, that was a pretty successful combat. Of course, now Pyrrhus' forces are disrupted, but the Romans there are useless. And, you know, the main thing they're going to take is huge siege losses, although there are options to use things like treachery to try to take the city, which would be based on the campaign rating. Unfortunately, there's only one Roman leader here anymore, so there's only one Guile there. So if I blew, say, 2 of my Guile, I could get a +1 on the table. The IDS for the city, it's a minor city, so it should be basically a 1. I should have a pretty good chance of being able to get in there now. The campaign rating of 6, I'll only need a 5 or better. But that lets the Romans get away, and my main reason for sieging this is to bottle them up. So it's not a hell of a lot of help to get a successful siege of a minor city. Best thing I can do is probably try to attrition them to death. All right. Okay, the next initiative is actually goes to Pyrrhus. And, well, the rules prevent you from moving a commander out of the OC or an OC, because the Romans have different layers of hierarchy, but out of the OC stack, but they don't restrict the OC from leaving on his own and going to grab more troops, as far as I can remember. I didn't bother looking it up, of course. After doing some diplomacy, which was mildly successful, and raising up troops all over the place, Pyrrhus went out and laid siege to the other Roman force. So right now the Romans are left with, hey, can we raise an army to relieve either of those sieges? The troops in both of them are not particularly in good shape. These guys are useless, and these guys are disorganized. I'm hoping that I recovered them properly. I can't remember completely, but I think we had a big battle here, which is why those are useless, and these guys probably, I think were useless before, after a fight with this guy. So essentially, we've got sieges ready to happen everywhere. This one's not yet under siege, and a big pile of troops here. I'm not quite sure if Pyrrhus could have just gone down and grabbed the extra. Oops, I got. No, the extra Tarentines down here. Again, dealing with the rolls is a pain is pain enough that I kind of try to fudge most of these things. That's one that I can't really come to a decision on. And I doubt that the rules actually specify in a way that would leave me satisfied, though. For a rather massive siege attrition effect here, where the Romans lost really two of their consular armies, they're down to one now. We've got a new consular army here that I built up with the Roman Consul. He got his chit pick over there. And he actually did some diplomacy in Campania, didn't want to keep pulling on that. After raising the troops, he marched down and attacked Milan. And they're both in the same hex there. Neither one withdrew. They took 15% losses each, which actually has both forces disorganized. I forgot about that 15%. It's helpful for me to speak about the game in the same way as it's helpful to play it as an opponent. Honestly, if I play something purely solitaire, I'm more likely to make mistakes than I do on video, even. Just to give you an idea, I'm more likely to correct them on video. I just play through. Now, I actually enjoy not making mistakes, so it's not that bad to screw up and not know about it. Milan here withdrew from Capua in order to recover. And then Mago went and actually captured Syracuse. That's going to have some effect on this. It's possible that they could end up, I don't know, maybe driving from the war. I really don't know what the possible result of that is, but they do affect Syracuse's will somehow there. Might have to make up some rules for that. Mako should have, he should have a point of guile over here. I'm keeping his forces along this board bottom just because there's, no place to keep them otherwise. There actually should be a third power chart, simply because there's a scenario with three players. One thing I've been thinking about a little bit with the way that the, fighting and then pulling back and trying to reorganize, maybe not the pulling back so much, but the time to reorganize your army before pushing on, that it reminds me of is kind of the flavor of Eric Smith's Civil War. Just this feeling of, okay, my army, I did this big fight and I'm not ready for another one necessarily. It's not as terrible to be disorganized, I'm sorry, disrupted, as whatever the effect, I think it's a disorganization in Civil War has. But it is, once you get to disorganized, it's pretty bad. And once you get to useless, you are indeed useless. And there's just something interesting about this. No matter what, if you fight a battle, unless you get an overrun, you're going to be somewhat lessened. And if you fight two straight battles, you will be disorganized and no longer really an effective force in combat again because of the penalties. Much more important than the number of troops that you have in the battle is your leadership and your organization quality, any elites or veteran legions, stuff like that. Those things all provide more pluses usually than, adding some extra units would. So usually you don't want to go in with a larger force if it means, adding a penalty for being disorganized or something along those lines. Here, a quick Roman recovery action on one of these with the proconsul. Shit, draw. We had an augury. And this was kind of a cute one. It didn't have any effect. Set it Axe Huffy, possible Italian revolt. You roll a die for every city in which there are troops inside. And if the base defense factor, so in the one, two cases there are cities, it's both small cities, plus the number of troops. If you can exceed that amount, the thing revolts and becomes not really either players, which is kind of cute, using the little in revolt markers that we used in the last scenario as well. And the cup ran out as we finished turn five there. Only really exciting thing, Mago came up and besieged Syracuse, which is, or their forces, which we've got there. In a sense, I always feel kind of funny leaving something like this open, but the truth is, Syracuse doesn't have an army sufficient to take Syracuse back. In fact, Syracuse may be controlled by now, but that doesn't really, I think, affect anything. I have to look at the diplomacy rules again, but military control over somebody you don't have diplomatic control doesn't like wipe them out, as far as I remember. If you manage to somehow get political control, though, you may. Now, I'm wondering about allowing the devastation roll of 4 boxes for the territory that you devastate to be applied to the diplomacy side of things for instead of for looting. Just because it's obvious. I mean, if you read the Berg's discussion on Pyrrhus being too much of a gentleman to burn down cities, and that the locals were doing it all the time, and obviously Pyrrhus just didn't understand how things were done in Italy. There's no incentive to do it. It's only a negative thing the way the rules are stated, although it's implied that there is this huge positive morale effect, given that taking a major or medium city is of value anyway. It seems to me that I'm gonna make up some kind of rule for this. Maybe I'll look at the online rules, see if they change that. It was not present in the Carthage rules, though, even though the same implications, kind of without a rule to back them up, are there. Also, did the recovery. Oh, Pyrrhus left his force. It's kind of leaderless. And that could be kind of dangerous if he doesn't get a quick draw with himself or one of his leaders. Just because being leaderless can be pretty damn lousy. I also don't know what's going to show up here. But otherwise, we've got the recovery. The Italians are in bad shape. But of course, they always have the ability to build more troops in Rome, and there's a lot of space between them and Pyrrhus's command. So I don't know. The 50-point victory condition. I looked over the victory conditions because I feel like, well, a little earlier. I'm getting to the point in the game where I should worry about that. There's an automatic victory at 50. I don't know if that's even possible. There are, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Yeah, you wouldn't have Rome. So 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 provinces times 3. Yeah, I guess it is. That's like 48 points. But basically, you have to dominate Italy in order to get that, because there are some additional points for things like Capua and some of the other major cities. But we're not anywhere near there with the Pyrrhic. However, they may end up, if they do well, being able to hold on, especially since Carthage is stuck over here on Sicily. Sure, I'm going to lose whatever points I'm getting for Sicily. There are a decent number there, but I don't think I can win that fight. That looks a lot less hopeful than trying to beat the Romans. And I guess we can remove our different ambassadors that we've used. And again, Rome's got kind of this Fabian strategy that has their troops hiding in the cities. Not in particularly important ones, though. But we promoted Moose, or demoted, or whatever. Moose and Caudinus are both our proconsuls now. And that adds two pro council chips to the cup, and our councils are only have 1 point each as well. Our new one, Miranda here, pretty lousy. And then Brutus. Nothing too positive there, which may be good signs for the Imperiates. I haven't really been moving the navies around or playing with them. It's kind of hard for me to decide what to do about that. One person gets the right to do it, and it's kind of pretty random. I mean, you can shift them all over to one side or another or whatever, but then the other guy gets a right to change them. It looks actually as though there's not going to be much navy here. So let's take a look, see who gets it. Odd, it's Roman, even it's... Okay, so the Greeks have to go first. They're happy, I think, with how things are. They may actually... See, I'm looking at their coastal territories along here that we may be making sieges against some of these ports here, like Naples, Cumae, etc. It looks like we've won over here, so I may shift a couple over that way. The problem here is these are negative for me. So if I were to shift, say, three out of here, I'd end up at plus one, but these would both be zeros then. Of course, so the Romans would be down to negative four, which means I wouldn't lose anything. Likewise, over here, I'm not really hurt. So I think I'm going to do that. I think I'm going to shift three from my stronger naval areas into the Tyrrhenian Sea. Well, Mago gets an activation, which he more or less skipped. So I don't want to bring more troops into here. Attrition's what's doing the job either way. Two Rome Council activations, both used to raise legions. The current commander, whatever his name is, Miranda, is so bad with that four continuation campaign number that he can pretty much only guarantee he gets one. Well, four isn't that terrible. There are threes out there, but I'm used to fives and sixes. And anyway, he failed both times, so all he got was his couple of legions up into play, which I think are here. The third army here is under him now. And then we had an attrition. And attrition's always cool. It's, you know, it affects both people. Big sieging armies have real problems with it, but big armies inside do. I really like the way the siege works operate in this. It's not as innovative as, like, Kingdom of Heaven's card-driven siege play. But you have less knowledge of what's going to happen. But it's kind of cool to just roll on the attrition tables. The negative side is that treachery doesn't seem that valuable unless you're trying to grab a city right at the end of the game for some reason. Also, the actually assaulting the city looks painful when there's troops inside, which doesn't bother me too much. It should be. So it's got a nice balance. The treachery not allowing you to go in and slaughter the inhabitants as easily is kind of problematic. Let me look if looting allows you to do that. That may be the advantage to looting when it comes down to it. Maybe it's that when you take a city by treachery, you're able to kill everyone. In which case, maybe it is worth it. Yep. You can do it by treachery. Treachery allows, I believe, the things to come out if they're not sacked. If I recall correctly. So, trying to see if there's an effect of treachery listed here. If you sack them, you get to wipe them out. So, treachery might be a worthwhile action if you're going to try to slaughter the opponents. Otherwise, they get a chance to get away. Next thing to come up was an augury. And that augury reminded me of another role. But I got a severe drought in Italy. What that's going to do is drop... Basically, you take two rose down to the worse as to towards the bottom of the chart as to what your damage from attrition is for any kind of inaction or movement attrition. It's not going to affect sieges, I guess. Unless I mistook that. No, it adds one to siege attrition and it'll eat die rolls, which is about equivalent. Those die rolls are kind of spaced out a little bit.
Right.
And it doesn't affect, regular drought wouldn't affect that. There's kind of an annoying situation here. The severe drought in Italy, Chet, is on the back of the drought in Sicily and vice versa. Just a counter misalignment thing, but it's possible that you couldn't get the two counters that you need in play. If they had been severe drought in Italy and drought in Italy on the same side, on the same chit, that would be fine. Anyway, then Pyrrhus went, rallied, raised some forces, didn't get a continuation, took his next turn, moved up to here, didn't get enough of a continuation to attack. And all the while, he's left this force uncommanded, which is kind of problematic. The attrition really isn't that big a deal. He lost a couple of units marching this way. I've got to worry. I got a big force here. But, oh, the thing that I learned that I've been forgetting about. When you move into a city, you get to subtract its IDS number, its defense strength, which for the little guys is just one, from your attrition accumulation, which, probably not that big a deal in general. Most of my movements have been to small cities, but, you know, it might cost a unit here or there. But it is, you know, one of those neat little facets to the game that easily forgotten, but when you notice it, either reading the rules or actually playing and realizing you haven't been doing it, you kind of think, wow, that's cool, kind of. It makes sense. We had another attrition thing, but then I remembered something that I had seen in my mind when I was swimming. Sometimes my phrases don't come out quite the way they should for a reasonable consumption. It was that, you know, I was kind of disturbed about the counters. You're paying for a lot of counters, different color. And honestly, Empires in Arms and a number of other games have this issue as well. I'm not surprised that it's the case that somebody would print a game with tons and tons of counters, which are kind of expensive, which really don't serve a lot of purpose. When you're just storing them on here, here's what I would suggest. Everything on tracks. Yeah, I know, some people don't like that. You couldn't eliminate all the counters, because every now and then, although with the city cards you could, right? If you basically a set of, hey, here's infantry strength points from a certain color, here's cav strength points from that color. You could range them so that, you know, you could get, with two tracks, any reasonable amount, you know, a tens digit and a ones digit. Any reasonable amount of forces that would be in an army. And if you had more than that, you could put another set of counters on them. So look, you know, you just got yourself up to 200 instead of up to 100 or whatever, you know. It wouldn't be that painful. That would cut down on the counter mix by a great deal. And frankly, it would make counting easier. Because instead of having to count up all these little units that max out at 10, and sometimes for large forces, it can be an issue, especially if you're doing sloppy stuff like I do. You know, like this, that's a six right there, basically. You know, you got extra counters in play, etc. A small handful, perhaps, of counters to use in the cities, probably not even necessary there. That could all be done on tracks as well. And you'd have everything covered just fine that way. Anyway, just a thought among, you know, sort of most people who review a game don't really consider the components in that kind of way, but that's immediately what I start thinking about. When all you've got is generic strength points, and frankly, they're not that different. So like these Italians aren't really significantly any different from the Tarentiums unless maybe I can't move these with the Aperiates, which I haven't decided yet. I can't figure that out from the rules themselves. I don't see any indication that I can't. there are very few pieces that matter. Now, maybe there's some scenarios, some augury events, that it does matter by nationality. You still can get by with a lot less counters than you have. And, you know, in the unlikely event that maybe you need more than, say, 8 sets of Tarentium pieces, and I can't imagine that ever arising in this scenario, people can always make them fairly easily if they're going way outside of the counter mix. It doesn't seem like there's any counter mix limit. There's no rule that states that, and it wouldn't make a lot of sense. Mago got a activation he didn't really want. He's not going to assault the city. Can't leave it be. Just not much he can do. Then the proconsul chit was picked, and I sent Muse out to attack the still leaderless force here. Ended up with a draw. I think I screwed up, actually. It was a 10 to 15, and I think I did it 10 to 10. Let's see. We're going to take some more hits here. There was a cav hit that was there that I didn't catch. But that's not enough to count as any kind of defeat. It doesn't force the siege to be broken. And honestly, that siege is at a 1 level now. That's not a terribly important siege anymore. Oh, Pyrrhus got his action. I think his last one, he only has 3. Which was, he diplomatized Campania. And actually, it's beginning to, you know, make its way down. It hits 4 over there and it switches sides. But as it stands, it's still considered Roman controlled. And, you know, strangely enough, the neutral territories don't count against Rome. They're not providing manpower, but these do. They reduce Rome's ability to raise legions, so there's something to worry about, but the neutral's not terribly much. One problem, of course, with that is I don't have an easy way to mark military control. Maybe if I left these alone and said, well, if something surrendered, I can use the red D. I don't know. But it's not really a big issue right now. But anyway, Pyrrhus ended up besieging Capua with a large force. But now his siege here has been kind of broken. No. I allow Muse. If I can. You know, I'm not looking at the rolls terribly much, but it seems to me that if you attack with enough force that you're not forced back in, you can probably push your way out. Maybe that's in the rules, actually, or something. But I like to make things up with games like this. I feel like it... Yeah, see, it doesn't make any statement about what happens when, at least that I can see, under the sallying and rescue. Maybe there's some other place in the rules where it says it, but it sounds like you can just come out no matter what. I've kind of a house rule to say, well, if you're defeated, you probably get shoved back in, right? I don't know. That's just how I feel about it, because you probably actually want to be. But if you're not defeated... Well, if you retreat back in, you are defeated. That's the nature of defeat, is that you retreated somewhere. If you're not forced to retreat, and maybe you could go somewhere else, if you're not forced to retreat, if you stay in and you choose to stay, then you haven't lost the battle. And the only way to not lose a battle is not to retreat. So that's kind of how I figured it out, but I've got some disagreement with the idea of being able to push your way through and get out without being, you know, when you are defeated. Just maybe that's not unreasonable, because these kind of sieges really weren't full-on blockades usually. So I'm not so sure that an army couldn't force its way out even after being defeated. I thought to jump to the newest of rules for this, and those have completely different rules involving a sally table and all kind of other stuff that's not contained. This is the 2.0, maybe not the newest. Let's look at the newer rules here, see if they changed. But obviously, this was something that wasn't fleshed out enough in this rule book. And I could probably use the more recent system and the charts from it and la la la. That's something I was forced to do with the other Berg game that I did on the Spanish Succession battles from Moments in History. Let's see if there's anything more interesting here.
Nope.
I kind of like these rules because they coordinate both the sally and a relief effort. And it all makes sense the way I kind of made it up with, hey, you can make an attempt to coordinate those, but if you don't succeed, you're stuck in the city and you watch the battle happen. It all worked well in my mind. I'm sure that these are more precise and actually work out better, but I'm not going to switch gears at this point to new sets of tables and such. Now, let's see if I can remember where I was and where I got to. Over here, Milon marched down, took command of the forces there, threw a siege on an assault, lost a couple of strength points, I don't remember, like 3 or 4, quite a bit considering the situation, and took the city. That would, probably not necessary because he's just disrupted, but, well, whatever. And we'll get to why he's under siege there, because the guy he left there put him under siege, right? Well, that was the last thing that happened in the turn. Otherwise, we had a siege attrition check, actually, yeah, and a number of the forces reduced even further. Basically, you just have to wait outside. Now, this, although it's a fairly small force, is big enough to siege a level 1 city, no matter how many people are in it, and that can cause a problem if you stay in that city and don't come out. Now, I think he's actually got more troops than what's inside of it, but it's just based on the intrinsic defense strength of the city. The bigger the town, the more troops you need to surround it. And at the very at the highest level, you only need 7 for the biggest cities, so it's not terribly difficult. Most armies are big enough to do that. Now we'll get to recovery, and then we'll be starting a new turn. And I'm going to load this up while I recover.